My name is Knut, and you can ask me about SSDs and storage.
My name is Pradeep.
Awesome. My name is Pradeep Dubey. You can ask me about artificial intelligence and machine learning.
Systems and also applications.
My name is Genevieve Bell. You can ask me about things to do with users and human beings.
My name is Alberto Martinez. You can ask me about systems, IOs, and audio, voice, and speech recognition.
My name is Mark Bohr. You can ask me about process technology, but not the secret ingredients.
My name is Sudhan Mukherjee. You can ask me about network, wireless paper, as well as 5G.
My name is Vivek. You can ask me about SOC design and surveys.
My name is Amber. You can ask me about storage and SSDs if you don't like his answers.
My name is Prashant Sethi. You can ask me about operating systems and software on our architecture.
Okay, so we're about to start. In order to kind of get your juices flowing, we have door prizes for questions that are asked. This time, traditionally they've been either Lowe's or Home Depot cards, and folks have like renovated garages and kitchens and so on after coming to these events before. This year, we have Amazon gift cards. I would not make it without Amazon Prime, and so they're Amazon gift cards this time. So the runners have a pile of them. Half of them are probably in their pocket by now. The other half they have to pass out. If you have a question for a specific person, then go ahead and call it out. We've kind of got the cheat sheet up here. And if you just have a question and you don't know who it's for, then just do the question and we'll try to triage it. Go ahead.
Hi, I have a question.
Genevieve, it's Ben Wood from CCS Insight. Hi, Genevieve, nice to see you. I'm very intrigued on your views on virtual reality because it strikes me that in about 5 or 10 years' time, we're going to look back at these ridiculous boxes that people were strapping on their heads and wonder what on earth we were thinking. So how do we get from that position and what impact is it going to have on society?
Okay, so a big question then, virtual reality discuss. I mean, one is tempted to channel Gandhi and say it's neither. You know, if one remembers this line about Western civilization, that it seemed like a good idea. Virtual reality may be a not dissimilar thing. There are two twin ways you need to think about it. One is there are a series of extant technical challenges that have to do with both how do you get the content into a headset, how do you get a headset to a sufficient weight and size and bulk that it doesn't seem like a strange thing to attach to your head, how do you solve some of the visual prolapse problems, because at the moment for anywhere between 10 to 20% of the population it is still nausea, dizziness, headache inducing. So there's a series of significant technical challenges that need to be resolved. There are running in parallel to that a series of challenges that are more social and cultural, which are about what are the experiences that will bring us back more than once. I think the most interesting thing about Pokemon Go over the last month and a half was that it demonstrated that playfulness is still an important driver for technology experience adoption. I think the challenge with fully occluded virtual reality is what it's going to mean for narrative. What is a story that will work where it is you and the story alone? How do we rethink the idea of a narrative, which has always been linear and driven by an author, effectively on the rails with an idea of what does she want you to know? Imagining a story where you as the participant can now pivot to a different place in the narrative means thinking very differently about it. So the people that are in some ways experimenting most aggressively, Disney and sporting franchises, clearly understand that it's about what is a story that will bring you back time and time again. And I think the hardest challenges to solve here are going to be the technical ones, but also the what's the human thing you want to do with it? What's the story? What's the experience? What's the thing in which you want to be immersed? And yeah, there's lots of experiments that are ongoing at the moment that are interesting. Between the New York Times, what came out of Rio, some of the early things from lots of different companies, but in some ways until you get to that problem, even solving the technical problems doesn't solve it for you.
So for those of you that have questions, we've got two mic runners, and so if you make yourself known while one question is being answered, then we can get things prefetched. So we'll get this one next after that one. Go ahead.
Okay, yes, a question for Mark. Where do you see FPGAs fitting into HPC, and in particular opportunities to replace fixed function black boxes that were previously FPGA based?
Yeah, there's a lot of interest and FPGAs coupled with Xeons
Had meetings today with a couple of integrators where they actually want to put OmniPath into an FPGA in order to accelerate the data volumes that they can process. The other pain point today we're talking about is the programmability, and that's one of the great things that we have with the next generation of FPGAs is an OpenCL programming model that's a lot like C++. And so we see a lot of edge computing happening in HPC scientific devices, collecting data like CERN, Large Hadron Collider, and other large experiments now that are making decisions on the fly, about what data to collect at the edge where the devices are. And this is revolutionizing astronomical surveys and other areas like that. So the adoption curve is sort of flat right now, but we see it starting to kick up because of the integration with the processor, the integration with the fabric that I mentioned as well. So it's a really exciting time.
What took you so long? You're third.
It's Jim Handy, Effective Analysis. I have a question for the other Mark that is going to test his ability to be diplomatic. The successor to ITRS that I can't remember the name of right now just recently released a roadmap that says that Moore's Law is going to come to a grinding halt. And I wanted to know what your opinion was of that finding.
So again, Moore's Law is going to end. This is about the 30th time in the last 30 years. Okay. Well, first of all, for those of you who don't know, ISTR is the International Semiconductor Technology Roadmap. It was an industry-wide group that would get together once a year and decide where the industry was headed and what new dimensions and new tools and new materials might be used. Intel really saw the value of that effort diminishing, and we had kind of stepped out of that several years ago. So Intel has not participated in ISTR for quite some time. And we're not a part of this new group, which I think has a lot of university professors leading it, talking about scaling beyond Moore's Law. And I frankly don't give it a whole lot of credibility. That's as diplomatic as I can be.
I have another question for Mark Moore, Sanjay from Applied Materials. And we have often heard from you about the reuse of equipment as Intel moves across nodes. With EUV, what sort of percentage of reuse are you looking at?
So, you're pointing out number one, it's an Intel's long-held strategy as we develop each new generation of technology, going from 22 to 14 to 10, that we try to reuse a fair percentage of the equipment on the new generation, so we're not having to buy a whole new set of tools. And your question was directed more towards the EUV, that when we introduce EUV, what percent of the tool set has changed? That's kind of an odd question, because the problem we're facing without EUV is that the number of immersion layers, the number of immersion lithography steps is increasing at a dramatic rate and adding a lot of cost to the process. So our hope and our expectation is that for the 7-nanometer generation, EUV will become mature enough where it can replace some of the immersion layers or slow down the growth in the number of immersion masks in the process flow. But it doesn't change all of the thin film and etch and clean tools that we need to use. Did that answer your question?
Thank you. All right, does anybody have a question for Amber? She's, what, a new fellow on the panel? And she's never had a question.
And can we just pause to note, first time in Fellows Live Unplugged and Uncensored that I can think of where you have two female fellows on stage.
No.
Hey, no. I've just suffered working for Commit for over a decade, so.
No, there was somebody else from TNG.
Kaylin
was on a pick.
Never on both of us.
Of a hard drive?
Yeah, rotating hard drive.
Of rotating hard drives. So we're really excited. Many of you may have attended Flash Memory Summit last week, and you saw that there's more and more evolution. And so one of the things Facebook called for was what they call worm, you know, write once storage, essentially, for NAND. And so we're really excited about the way we see that both today you're seeing hot and warm tiers move to SSDs already. And then in cold tier, we think that there's a great spot for NAND there as well, especially as you head towards QLC. And so we're really excited about the future looking very bright there. And from my perspective, I would love to see hard drives move towards where tape is at. But we will see if we can deliver on the technology to make that a reality.
Hi. While the components of the data centers are getting faster and cheaper, we are generating enormous amount of data from our mobile devices, connected devices. And as consumers, we do not have patience to run deep learning algorithm before I get an answer to a, you know, so problem, I need an answer right away. So, and 5G is not here. I don't have the time to really transfer all the data to the cloud and learn a deep learning algorithm on all the GPUs before I get an answer to a problem. So, how do you think that challenge will be resolved?
So you don't have to actually wait for 5G for that. There is this concept of mobile edge cloud, or some companies call it fog networking. Essentially what is happening, even today with LTE and LTE Pro as you go, the density, the data density as well, the connection density is increasing, particular square. So you cannot, as you said, you cannot transfer all the data to some remote central location to do any kind of decision making. So a lot of this intelligence is actually moving in that edge. So they are, you know, opening up on the PDCP layers on the base station, on the S1U between base station to core network, as well as in the core network. The other thing is happening, a lot of the operators, and John Donovan actually alluded to some of this, there's distributed core network elements of it. That's also getting closer to the edge. So you essentially have a cloud paradigm and framework. You have the IP packets there. You can do anything there. A lot of content distribution networks, CDNs of the world are also moving towards more and more as the edge. That base station. So you will see more decision making. This will come more handy as we get into the smart cities where you have a lot of data coming in a dense amount.
Hi, my question is for Pradeep, and it's around machine learning. If you look into the near future and beyond, where do you see Intel as a business using unsupervised and predictive analytics?
So unsupervised learning is hard. So most of what we have done so far, industry has done is supervised. Right? Someone labeled the data, not experts, someone. So we are slowly trying to go from there to actually doing in online incremental learning, online learning, right? And see if we can bootstrap with small amount of unsupervised and then just keep going and learning from based on how it does, right? So I think the combination of what we're doing now with sampling and reinforcement learning will get us there, because in general the problem of training purely unsupervised is just very hard. So in the short term I see the combination of deep learning with reinforcement learning getting us quite good.
Yeah, question here. I'm Brian Berg, Technical Chair of Flash Memory Summit. Nice to see you, Amber. Question for you. It seems like Intel is perfectly positioned with its processors and with its flash-based storage to be able to use analytics to more intelligently cache data in its flash and in the many tiers that are in our memory hierarchy. So what do you see as the future for that?
There's some really interesting things that are being worked on within the data center group on TAP and some other capabilities on analytics. And one of the things we've been focused on when we look at the evolution of flash storage is also how do we get away from some of the block level access? And so one of the really open questions right now that's going on among several people is, you know, with object storage, is that ever going to migrate to the drive level? Do we end up with key value interfaces within the drive? And how does that evolve? And so I think that will be some of the evolution away from block-based, and some of the offload is an active conversation. And you're highlighting, Brian, that analytics is certainly one of the things we're considering for that. But I say stay tuned.
Hi. This is Melina Demerzi. I'm with Oracle. I have a question for Pradeep, I would guess. So my question is about scalability. with larger and larger data centers and all these devices and everything, but our programming models are the same. We still use fine-grained logs, we still use latches. Some years ago, it might have been a shift in the paradigm with transactional memory that was released with, I think, Haswell. But apparently it's not, so what's your opinion on the next paradigm for scalable computing, or we're stuck? Thank you.
So, at least for machine learning, we see a hope, right? Programming frameworks at programming levels are moving up the stack, right? So we're no more programming, or most people are not programming at the level of OpenMP API, but they're moving up to the frameworks, right? That makes it easier for that community at least, right? That you can now create your own neural networks, right? And get going in those frameworks. So that framework, that high-level abstraction is a useful sign and a hope, right? Now, today it's primarily happening for deep learning and then for some more of machine learning. It doesn't apply to everything, but I see more hope in these higher-order programming frameworks, as well as languages like Julia, for example, for high-performance computing. So, still too soon to tell, but there's some hope.
From Insight 64. Roughly every 20 years, we've increased the size of the wafers we use to manufacture chips. We went from 200 to 300, not quite 20 years ago, but we're pushing 20. And it seems that the move to 450 is currently stalled because we have to get EUV working at 300 first. So my question for Mark or anybody else who wants to take it, if they're that silly, is, can we get to 450 if we don't have EUV working on 300? Is there a deadlock condition here, or how do we get to 450?
Well, I think one obvious part of the answer is that no one company can convert to 450 millimeter wafers alone. It really has to be an industry-wide effort because it's very expensive to develop the complete tools that need it. So there really has to be first a consensus between all the major equipment vendors and the major manufacturers to do that. And I think right now, most of us are much more concerned about the lithography solution. We really need EUV or something like EUV to help improve patterning. But 450, I think, will eventually come. It's just that it's not as critical, I think, as EUV is.
So the 300 EUV is a necessary first step to get to 450.
That's my view, yeah. And I don't know if EUV is necessarily tied to 300. You know, it's just one more tool that would have to develop the larger wafer size version. So it's a really, we all want the lithography improvement first, and then we'll start to worry again about the wafer size increase.
Is there an alternative to EUV if for some reason EUV is?
Certainly not as promising as EUV.
Hello, this is a bit of a broad question for Pradeep. And I was recently reading In Our Image by George Zacharias, and it got me thinking about uncertainty and potential ethical questions of AI. And I was wondering what Intel's rebuttal would be to those sort of questions and uncertainties from the public.
Ethical questions related to AI? Is that the So at this point, our most important thing we're trying to do is do the research related to AI all in the open. But that's one way to make sure it stays ethical, right? So the open part of AI is I think goes a long way in keeping and making sure that it's actually stays ethical. So that's our goal. Now, other than that, I don't know the other implications. It's just like, it's a science, it's a tool. It can be used and misused and just happen. It happened every time science did something. There's a very interesting article on this, by the way, in the last Scientific American. He talks about how to actually make sure that the super machine never does the super bad thing. It's a very interesting article. I suggest you read it. He's argued philosophically how we can make sure and how it will not happen. But if you're interested in that.
Oh, I was wondering how long we have to wait.
David Cantor. So I have a question for anyone who wants to grab it. So Intel now has FPGAs and sells them on package with Broadwell. At some point, do you think it will migrate inside of the CPU core? And if so, what would you prioritize in terms of other IA features like virtualization and power management and so forth?
I'm the talkative person that take all the questions that no one answers. And the first answer, let me figure out what you asked first. So you're saying, we had in the package of FPGA today, you are thinking we are going to migrate to the process node that we have the CPU and the graphics engines, and you're asking what would be the priority. Very tricky question, because I don't think we know what would be the priority by the time we
That's not the question.
Do you want to stick it inside the CPU core itself instead of just
the
a separate
core
block?
Itself. Well, that is a tough one. Is I want to have my way, which is not the Intel answer, if I want to have my way, I will integrate cells that are programmable in the CPU at some point. Whether that technology is granted to be able to do that and the node process is the correct one to ever to do achieve that, I don't know. That will ask Mark, right? He is the man behind that kind of things. But from the point of view of the programmability, the opportunity and the value add, programmable cells that are at the right node level and the right density probably are very valuable at some point. So from the software standpoint, I would say that will be very enticing. But at the same time, it will be very, very challenging from the point of view of what the operating system will do and how the operating system will handle the complexity of a programmable hardware logic that it can be changed at any given point of time.
So let me expand upon that excellent answer. CPU and FPGA process technologies are pretty similar, but not always the same. So in some cases, I can see the value of integrating both functions together onto one chip. In other cases, I see the value of designing those two chips separately and putting them together side by side in the package. And when you have a real dense package interconnect technology like an EMIB embedded bridge, I think that really facilitates that. It really lets you have your cake and eat it too. You know, optimize process technologies for the two functions and put them close together with a very very wide of us between the two. Thank you, David, for an excellent question.
Also, with respect to your power and virtualization question, those are today baseline requirements that we wouldn't consider anything if we don't look at virtualized and power optimizations.
Three fellows.
Hello, Hugo Castellanos, and I do work at Intel, but don't worry, I'm not going to ask anything confidential. So, Alberto, since you're answering questions now, and also, Jeremy, I have a question about voice recognition and UX. How do we interact with PCs and all the devices around us? So I use my phone all the time for reminders. It's a glorified digital post-it. Remind me of doing something or the other. So how do you see in the future voice recognition getting better and people interacting with it in a more elegant and developed manner?
Thank you for the question. That's a very interesting one for me, given that I work in that area. So the first thing is, when you have a device that is designed for a particular input interface, so you have a device that's designed for keyboard and mouse interface, having a secondary interface or other interfaces becomes secondary for the user. So if the user is intending to use a platform as a type and click interface, touch becomes secondary to that interface. And voice become tertiary to that interface. So as we move forward, however, what is going to happen, the people get used to the voice interface, and the voice interface break the barrier of 95% correct acceptance and below the one utterance over, I don't know, 100 hours, right, incorrect accepts. Then what will happen, the user will start migrating to the effectiveness of the voice interface as a very common and easy interface. And what will happen, and it's already happening, devices are emerging, they have no other interface than voice. The primary interface becomes voice. Those devices are still suffer of what I call the need of a secondary interface for programmability. So if you take some device I don't want to name names, but you want to activate a voice-only device today, you need a phone to enter information in that device in order to get it activated. That means the operating system is still dependent on some other interface to make it work. At some point, that barrier will be broken. The user interface will be continuous and homogeneous, meaning that we can talk to it without making a pause, and the reaction time is enough that it mimics human reaction times. And we're in the cusp of that, right? Everybody's racing in that direction. That's one aspect. The second aspect is, believe it or not, it's power. Today, all those utterances that people are saying to their devices are traveling to network interface, sitting in a server, and applying about 2 gigahertz of compute engine to decode the sound into text and then send them back and figure out what to do with it. It's like typing, and every type you do, this encode is going to a server to figure out what you type in the first place. That by itself goes from 10 to hundreds of kilowatt powers in the servers today, just for, I will say, a billion requests a week, 5 seconds per request. So that created a limitation on power, and that limitation on power had to be broken. And we're working really, really hard to do two things. We talk about moving things to the edge, right? By accelerating the processing of those, not only the ASR, but also the natural language interaction, moving to the edge, and allow the smartness to stay in servers that require their smartness. Did I answer your question, Nicole?
Yeah, thank you.
All right.
But there's a second piece of the answer, which also tends to turn on power, but a different kind of power, which is social power. So I'm willing to bet many of us have used voice interface objects as well as keyboards. We use them both. Imagine the last week of things you typed into Google. Now imagine saying those out loud with other people around you. Exactly. what you're up to. It turns out that voice works really well when it is singular, when it's you and an object, and frequently when there aren't other people around. Imagining a world of people all talking to their objects would be both cacophonous and possibly not particularly conducive to certain kinds of social relationships. The social power aspect comes in when, if you think about having an object that has voice recognition sitting in your home, it doesn't always know who it should listen to first. So if you say, turn on the television, and the person sitting on the other side of the sofa does not like that show and tells it to change channels, the device is now being asked to make a clarification about who has power in that relationship, which most of us as human beings are almost incapable of judging ourselves. So working out how to write the algorithm that says, well, Martha is in charge on weekends, but I'm in charge during the week, is actually pretty complicated. So one of the challenges becomes, and frankly, if you look at, we were actually talking about it before we got in here, the legacy of most objects is they have multiple interfaces sitting next to one another, frequently overlapping. And whilst keyboards may be remarkably old-fashioned, they endure because they allow us a certain level of control and privacy and a certain level of clear directiveness. Same in some ways with, you know, very boring things like, you know, remote controls. There's a reason why they still work even though they work poorly, is that it's clear who's in charge. So one of the challenges with voice becomes, it's fine if it's you and an object, but as soon as it's you and others and an object, there are a set of complications that get layered on there that aren't just technical, they're social. And so solving those problems involve power problems, but of a different kind.
Just a clarification, I'm never in charge. At home, never. Easy for me.
Hi, my name is Fred Whitridge, and I come here as an investor in Intel, and an investor in Micron, and an investor in IDTI. And I guess my question is about Intel as a partner, who sometimes can be very benevolent, and at other times I get the impression can roll over and crush its nest mates. And here at this session, one of the non-volatile memory tracks was basically all of the data that was put up, which was very little, was aimed at 3D XPoint as a DRAM killer. And I wonder how a partner like Micron that has 60% of its revenue coming from DRAM feels like that. So I guess my question is there any overall discussion, or is it ad hoc when you decide to make an investment like buying an Altera, or when you decide to productize and sell something versus working with a customer whose only job is productizing that?
Boy, I don't know if we really have any business folks here that really take that on. It strikes me not really as a technical question, and I think fellows are pretty well known for not being very business savvy.
speak for yourself, man.
All except for
I was about to say that on purpose, but.
But, you know, seriously, we are an industry of innovation. Are you suggesting we should not innovate? Are you saying we should not try to crush the competition? Come on.
Well, but I think one thing in 3D Crosspoint, if we were to look at it, is we were probably over-positioning if we say it's going to crush any particular thing. I think that if you look at 3D Crosspoint technology, it's really interesting in the way it fits between DRAM and NAND SSDs today. So I think there's a lot of applications that are going to use it as storage, and so that's where I've been really excited to use 3D Crosspoint and NVMe Express-based devices. And then it's also going to allow you to have what feels like a much bigger, faster memory, although it's going to be, you know, a memory hierarchy that's very interesting. So I'm not sure it's a killer of anything in my view. Technical view, not a business view.
I know only the paranoid survive.
Hi, this is Satish here. My question is very open, and what is Intel's view on quantum computers?
Well, it's not going to be in your laptop anytime soon.
Yeah,
there is growing research in.
I'll try to answer that. So we recently launched a research initiative that was publicly announced with Delft University in Europe to develop over the next 10 years the basic capabilities of building a quantum computer. A real quantum computer, unlike some in the market from D-Wave and so on. People claim that's not a real quantum computer because it doesn't use what's called entanglement amongst the qubits to perform the computing. So, you know, getting the basic building blocks at the physical level, you know, the qubits, the materials, the process technologies, the interconnects, putting it all together, you know, cryogenic, you know, 4 millikelvin is what, where things work today. So there are a lot of challenges, technical challenges, fundamental physics challenges to make progress on that front. A lot of the work that's happening at Delft and other places focuses on that. In parallel, there is effort in the research labs in Intel to look at the software stack, the architecture that will eventually have to be realized and optimized for using qubits and using the basic building blocks the way they're being developed. So, you know, our sense is that within the next 10 years, if you can build one reasonably performing quantum computer for doing some optimization problems, faster parallel optimization, or doing some of the you know, factorization for prime factorization, for example, that can break RSA by doing extremely fast and scalable prime factorization. So those are the two kind of areas of workloads where you know, this can come and make a major impact going forward. And but it's not to replace a general purpose computer like we know today. It's not a replacement for computing as we know today and the way it's evolving. It's sort of another way of doing something much better for certain classes of workloads, which are pretty important.
Yeah, we have made a quantum simulator available publicly that you can run on classical machines, try to simulate quantum algorithm, QHipster, right? And in fact, there's just a paper that just got published. So we are collaborating in publishing with leaders on around how do you simulate and how do you look at different algorithms.
Okay.
So regarding Microsoft's policy announcements this year about Windows 8 and Windows 7 support for Kaby Lake, who wants to comment on whether or not there are fundamental performance and compatibility issues with those legacy OSs on Kaby Lake, or whether it's just a convenient excuse for Microsoft to put a knife in Windows 7 and Windows 8?
So with respect to the position for Microsoft, we won't be able to speak for Microsoft, but from an Intel perspective, we maintain a philosophy that Windows runs best on IA, and you know, IA runs best with Windows, and the best architecture for Windows. So going forward, we attempt to innovate and make sure that that mantra holds true. So we'll continue to innovate as we go forward. I think there's certainly a lot of new features that come in with the newer operating system. So I would actually encourage folks to, you know, look, be more forward looking and look at what the new technology brings in, and you find that between both Intel and Microsoft platforms with the newer platforms and the newer OS, you gain more than just the individual pieces.
So this is a panel with a lot of deep experience in the industry, and especially at Intel, and that's actually the heart of my question. Given the recent changes at Intel and what we've heard about in the last couple of years, and really the last couple of days, and the changes that are going to be required at Intel, how are you guys and gals, thank you Genevieve, congratulations Amber, helping to address this from within Intel from a technical perspective, given that you're also longtime Intel people who are trying to drive the change to the new Intel?
How about we start from a statement from the strategist?
We had a bet earlier about who would get the questions no one else wanted. I was hoping it would be Alberto, apparently it's me. Listen, I think there's a couple of pieces to that, is that while there has been highly visible turnover in our executive leadership team, there's also been a little less visible, I think, to the rest of the world, additions into the senior leadership across the whole company. So we have had an influx of new fellows who come in as fellows, not grown up inside the company, but bringing new ideas from other places, including the Altera acquisition and a few other places. So in fact, there is a tremendous influx of new thinking into this team, as well as into the leadership ranks beneath that. So in fact, what we are already seeing is places where we didn't have a deep competency and growing it internally over time wasn't an option, we're actually recruiting aggressively against a range of different kinds of profiles, basically. So one of the answers is there is in fact a great deal more transformation happening through the technical leadership of the company than I think is sometimes visible.
So, Newt tried to make the claim earlier that we fellows don't know too much about business, and that's great. That makes us great agents for change. You know, we see, I think, better than some of our business leaders how the technologies are changing, how we need to do something different. Now, in my own case, you know, I really object to the supposition that the longer you are at a company, the less likely you will try to implement change. Well, I've been at Intel for about 38 years. I started working on DRAM technologies. Admittedly, I didn't do too well in that job. But you know, since then, you know, the group that I've been a part of, we introduced some industry-leading changes like IKMLGate and Trigate. So I think even experienced fellows know how to implement change.
You know, from a high-performance computing perspective, a lot of the technological changes that we've been talking about here today are rippling through all the way up to the high end as well. And you know, I came to Intel about 5 years ago from a national lab, and you know, the problems that we were facing were one, the memory wall was killing performance, the communication wall was limiting scalability of applications, and the IO wall was making it impossible to do the data analytics that we needed to do along with simulation science to get the scientific results out of it. And so in coming to Intel, I've seen a tremendous change in each one of those factors by going to in-package memory for you know, KNL and follow-on processors, that's Knight's Landing, and also the non-volatile memories in 3D NAND flash and 3D crosspoint are revolutionizing the way that we architect very large systems. We're moving away from disk-based systems to systems where the storage element, the long-term storage element, is like 2 inches away from the processor. That has a dramatic impact on the types of problems that we can solve and the advances that we can make scientifically and in the engineering space that make, you know, our modern economy move forward very rapidly. And so that's the kind of change that you're seeing from the fellows sitting in front of you today. We're thinking about the revolution in technology and how we can maximize the impact in our various business units.
Just to echo the comments that Uller was made, from the network infrastructure side of it, Intel is making one of the biggest bet, an investment on the wireless and 5G network. In last 2 years, we have done two acquisitions. So 700 plus new people have come in expertise in system on a chip, the IPs, and integration. So there's a huge amount of new ideas, new influx, and new areas of growth that we look towards.
Hi, my name is Marnie Fulton. I'm with the Storage Networking Industry Association. We're an education-based organization. And I'm very pleased to see the diversity that's on the panel. And I've been struck by the diversity and the youngness of in the videos and all the people that I'm seeing here. What are your comments on what kind of fellows you think you'll see up here in 20 years and what kind of technical expertise you think will be necessary to propel Intel and the industry forward? Thank you.
Well, apparently Mark will still be here, so that's good. I mean, in the nicest possible way, don't make that face at me. Well, given that I just insulted Mark, which is never good, and I just want to claim again, I didn't mean it. I mean, from where I sit, and I've always been clear about this, for me, I think, you know, not only is it about continuing to diversify our technical talent, and when you look across this panel, you see a new range of competencies that you might not have seen 10 years ago sitting on this stage. I also think it's critically important that this population resembles a little bit more the population that comes out of universities and graduate schools. So for me, that means there needs to be a continued push for, at the most basic level, more women. That would be good. Amber is lovely. She's great. Ruth Rain, who has joined us too, would be here but isn't. So we're making progress, but there is a tremendous more to do there. And then I think one of the things, and Mark's right to point this out, that's been remarkable in the time I've been in the fellow community is both the ways in which many people on this stage have reinvented their careers and their interests and preoccupations, and the fact that one of the amazing things about Intel is that you have, with every kind of passing cycle, new forms of technology that come to the fore and new experts that come with that. So I imagine, in my heart of all hearts, along with Mark sitting on the stage, and more women 20 years from now, you would also have a set of technologists who are the ones engaging with the critical questions, and that we would have anticipated those and invested in.
And I'm really excited for, you know, some of the problems we're working on today are not problems we can do in silos. And so one of the key things that both the diversity that we're seeing, some of it highlights some of the collaboration models of how we have to move forward, because we can't do anything in one particular organization. I certainly work with our data center group a lot to try to bring forward some of the new storage innovations we're looking towards. And it really encourages us, how do we work across boundaries is one of the things that I think we're seeing much more, as well as, you know, to the diversity of thought moving forward. How do we encourage people throughout their careers to continue moving forward and collaborating with each other and sponsorship? And I think that one of the things that I've personally seen that's helped me in my own career is the sponsorship from several people on this panel in my own career. So I worked for Knut for a decade, and he really taught me the ropes and how to, and how to collaborate with other people and how to identify what are the important problems to solve and all those things, and then I try to pay it forward to other people. So I think that we all have to encourage those new ideas and move forward.
Yeah, and the Internet of Things coupled with the data center back end and a large amount of data that we've been hearing about and that's being generated is driving an end-to-end solution mentality that is completely different than a chip supplier, right? And you see that in the disciplines represented here. You also see it in new business organizations like the one that kind of created recently that I'm in. The Scalable Data Center Solutions Group is thinking about how to build those partnerships, how to have cross-business unit technical teams that go out and solve very complex end-to-end problems for non-traditional customers. There's a bunch of industrial companies like GE, like John Deere, like Caterpillar, which are actually looking at themselves and saying, you know, It used to be, you know, manufacturing engines or manufacturing tractors was my business, but really today the business is digital. The business is the information that these devices are creating and the value that we can get out of that and the new services that we can supply back to our customers who are buying these devices. That's a completely different mindset. And if you want to think about where Intel will be in 10 or more years, it's that end-to-end kind of a solution space that I think we need to partner with multiple players in the industry to bring about.
Yeah, I mean, I think the question on 20 years later, the way Intel would stay relevant or any of us will still be here 20 years later is by staying, it's our job to stay one step ahead of wherever the industry is. And I can just give you an example of my own. So I was a microcoder on 486 from there to then getting some degree. And when I showed up Intel 2003, we're still talking Itanium versus x86. Not two core, Itanium versus x86. So from there to multi-core, to many-core, to big data, to machine learning, to deep learning, to neuromorphic computing, to quantum computing, it's been a long journey, right? All this happened in last 2003 to 10, 15, less than 15 years, 13 years.
Let me take a quick pause. We've got about 12 minutes left. Now see, just a show of hands, how many people are still just dying to get their question answered? We're just trying to get a sense for how far along we are. Okay, it's gonna be close. Let's keep going.
Hi, two questions for Amber. When do you see price parity between flash and hard drive? And second question is, when do we expect a seamless and uniform way of accessing data from the memory and storage systems? You know, the line is getting blurry with 3D crosspoint. So from a user's point of view, from a programmer's point of view, we like to access the data from anywhere in a very seamless way.
So I'll answer the second question, and then I'll punt the first question to Knut. On the second question, I think we are entering a really interesting paradigm where we've gone towards NVMe Express for the storage access, and we're seeing that also as we look across fabrics. So PCIe is the interface to the solid state drive itself, but you can access it across Ethernet, Omnipath, other things. And then you also have some great work that was done in the SNIA persistent or non-volatile memory twig towards persistent memory APIs and how that evolves over time. And I think a key thing we have to look at is as you have, you know, your different hot, warm, cold data tiers and their access of data, in some cases you're going to want to access persistent memory. And in some cases you're going to want to access still as traditional storage, and you're seeing NVMe over fabrics, persistent memory over fabrics. And I think we have over the next 5 years, I personally see one of the next big things we have to figure out is as an application, you just want access to your data. You really don't care whether it's over persistent memory or over NVMe. And so how do we unify that and give applications a building block for how they really get to fast storage, whether it's as persistent memory or storage? So I think that's gonna be an active thing that we work on. Knut, so when do we get parity? Next year, right? No.
Well, actually on the parity question, it's a little bit of a trick question because if anyone buying any 15K RPM drives anymore? Well, I think, you know, there's at least some examples where parity has already been achieved. And I think also in the question probably also presumed that it's price parity in terms of like the initial purchase cost per bit access data. And so it depends a little bit on what your value is. Whether you are valuing just the initial purchase costs, whether you are valuing performance or having performance requirements or so on. There's going to be a place for magnetic storage. That's not going to go get extinct. But the places where flash storage is becoming increasingly attractive, that seems like it's a growing segment. And the places where magnetics seems most attractive, that seems to generally be holding steady or maybe not growing at the same rate as flash is. But you know, magnetics isn't going to go extinct, at least until after the 20-year timeline that you guys gave us here on the stage.
And another way to look at that question is, you know, are there gaps in what we can actually build today because of the cost structure of and performance characteristics of disk versus flash. And in high performance computing, You know, I've been telling people for the last 5 years, you know, I can buy capacity, but I can't buy bandwidth. I run out of budget before I can get the bandwidth I need to supply data to, you know, the high performance computing simulation. With Flash, that changes. We today, you know, I'm architecting solutions for customers today where, you know, I can get to the bandwidth to them that, you know, for hundreds of thousands of dollars, where, you know, if I was to do that with disk drives, I'd need so many disk drives that it would be like $10 to $15 million for that same solution. So in terms of price parity on a bandwidth, the perspective of IOPS perspective, we're blowing the doors off of hard drives now.
Question. Photonics and disaggregation, we've been talking about it for 10 years plus, and it just never seems to get there. What's the issue about integrating directly onto the core? We thought Omnipath was going to be it. It's not quite there yet, so what's the direction?
I don't know who can take that one. Is that a circus question?
No.
No?
Just say it's difficult.
Yeah, it's a,
you may have actually found like the gap in our coverage today. So kudos to you.
Is he getting 2 cards for that?
Yes. Oh yeah, 2 cards for that. You got the stump and chump reward. Go ahead.
My name is Arvind. I work for Wind River. I actually have a couple of non-technical questions. One of the
Because you're an Intel employee. One question. That's cheeky.
What are the secret perks of being an Intel fellow?